Frostgrave is a fantasy miniature war games that I enjoy very much. I reviewed it early on when it came out. And now we have a companion game, or to say a reimagine of that game called Stargrave, because actually the original Frostgrave had a companion called Archipelago. Stargrave is a reimagining of the general main mechanics of Frostgrave in the future, in a science fiction world. Now, interesting enough, Frostgrave already, to me, wasn't just fantasy, it was Western. It felt very Western in a fantasy world, because it was about boomtowns, lawless lands. It wasn't so much about, you know, law and order. It really had that idea of desperados, explorers, drifters. And Stargrave also reproduces that in science fiction. So by being Frostgrave in space, Stargrave to me is also Western in space. And the setting here is, in fact, in the galaxy that has been devastated by some sort of big war, so there isn't a strong central government. So it's all about the scum and villainy, that aspect of the Star Wars universe. Has a distinct Firefly kind of feel to it. So again, it's bands of desperate explorers, people that are just trying to make money, to make a quick buck. You really have this roguish sense. There's even the rogue as a playing class. And so, as for the product itself, the game itself, it is this book. Then you will need to provide all of the physical components. I personally love the idea of miniature wargaming because of the tactical possibilities of moving in real space. But I'm not into the hobby aspect. I think I'm the laziest miniature war gamer that there is. And I'm, for example, I play with paper miniatures. I play with the paper mats that I print, two-dimensional. So I don't really have anything to show you to show you how amazing the game looks when I play, because it looks pretty average. Actually, by your standards, you spend all that money and time painting and building those miniatures and those terrains, probably my games would look pretty depressing to you, so I don't want to depress the heck out of you. I'm going to show you the manual itself instead. And it's production-wise, it's really good. You have the great art that you expect from Osprey books, nice glossy paper. So it's gonna be duels, it's gonna be skirmishes. This is the scale of Frostgrave and also Stargrave. And you're gonna have bands of humanoids mostly. Like in Frostgrave, that has, you know, main magic user, then a second in command, and then a number of hired helpers. Here we're gonna have a captain who's gonna be the main figure in the game. So first thing, when you create your band, you choose the species or the class of the captain. So instead of a necromancer, elementalist, or sigilist, here we have the biomorph, which is a creature that has been biomorphified or modified with limbs and other weird things coming out of their body. The cyborg, we all know what that is. The mystic, because the force is strong with characters in every part of the galaxy. Robotic expert, self-explanatory. The rogue, I told you, it's very important in this kind of setting here that everybody really feels a little bit like a rogue. The psionicist, with superpowers based on the mind. The techer, and the veteran, who is just your classic brawler. Now, Each captain has stat modifiers and core powers. Basically, there is a standard set of stats that you have for all the captains that will be modified. So the standard fighting, the veteran gets plus one. The attacker doesn't get any plus necessarily in fight, but get plus two in will, but then can use these other ones. Plus core powers, and you know, powers here work pretty much like in Frostgrave, especially in the Archipelago version. So after you create your captain, and again, this is the standard stat line that you will modify based on the kind of captain that you have, biomorphic, tech, or rogue. you will have then, after you create that, the movement factor, the fighting, the shooting, the armor, the will, and the health. When the health goes down to zero, and you are kaput. Then you have your first mate, also known as Exo, first officer, or number one in some sci-fi universe. Who has ever heard of that? The first mate has a different line, starting line, has it's just less good, has worse stats than the captain, has fewer powers. But what is interesting and different from the original Frostgrave is that the first mate doesn't have to be the same category, the same class as the captain. The original Frostgrave, your main helper was going to be a weaker sigilist, a weaker elementalist. Not here. And that's nice that you can mix and match. You can have a rogue working with attacker working with a psionicist, veteran with a robot expert, and so on and so forth. So I like the mixing and matching. After that, then you're going to recruit your general soldiers. And here they have their stats, and you're going to spend credits to recruit them. You can always recruit free ones, so you should never be, should never run out of muscle, and should never run out of people that are going to die for you. So that's how you create your band, weapons and all that. As for the turn structure, very important. You roll to determine who goes first, and then you're going to have different phases. In each phase, player one goes first, player two goes next, and then you do that for every phase. The captain phase, in which you activate the captain, any number of figure within 3 inches from the captain, so both sides do that. The first mate, in which, again, first player and then second player can activate their first mate, and other figures within 3 inches, and again, line of sight, and then players activate the remaining soldiers that have not activated yet, of course. And there are things you can try to activate as many people as you can here, because that momentum holds somebody back to come in and give the final push or to trick the opponent. And then the creature phase, pretty much like in Frostgrave, the scenarios will have non-playing characters, and they will activate here, and you use a simple AI to determine whom they slaughter, whom they're going to try to cause pain to, because that's very important. This game uses the 20-sided dice, which of course give you a pretty swingy situation, a large number of situations here. And the idea is, when you activate a figure, the figure can take up to 2 actions. One will be movement, and then you have other actions. So the most common ones are going to be combat and or to use powers. For combat, the idea is that you will, when 2 figures are caught in melee, they both roll dice. You roll d20, each rolls a d20. You add their fighting stats, you add possible other modifiers. They may come from so many different things: powers, weapons, scenario situations, etc. Whoever has the highest scores, a hit against the opponent, or at least wins that combat, and may be able to inflict damage. You compare the fighting result of the player that has the highest fighting result with the armor of the target. If the result is higher than the armor, then the difference is the number of points of health points then that the loser has to lose. That's simple. And shooting pretty much is the same idea. You also, of course, need to confirm line of sight and be within range. And this time, the stats that you add are shooting for the shooter and still fight for the defender. Other than that, is the same general idea. And then you're going to have, of course, a lot of stuff that you want to really give flavor to the game. And anybody who comes from Frostgrave will expect a large number of unique game effects to replace, to take the place of what are spells there, and that there are powers here. They work pretty much like in that game, especially if you're familiar with the Archipelago implementation, which is powers have an activation number. Powers have an activation number. And in order for you to use the power successfully, and of course there's a ton of them, to use the power successfully, you're going to roll a d20, you're going to apply all possible modifiers, and you're able to use the power if you roll the activation number of higher or higher after all modifiers. If you're just a little short, you can exert yourself, which means you can spend health points to pay for the remaining points to reach the activation value for on a one-to-one base. I'm 2 points short to activate my energy shield or to activate my fortune or my haggle or my mystic trance. And well, I'm 2 points short. I'm gonna lose 2 health points and then I can activate it. Some also require so much effort, like I'm pulling, that they will strain you. If you successfully activate them, then you also have to pay that cost in health points, which is the strain. Not every ability has the strain, but a lot do. And again, that you recognize the strain from as the new version of what used to be the Blood Curse in the Archipelago. Lots of power, lots of abilities. Lots of different scenarios. The standard scenario, again, similarly to what happens in the old Frostgrave, is that you're going to collect loot tokens. There are two different kinds of loot tokens: the data tokens, I like that cyberpunk element, you're stealing data, and the physical tokens. But again, the main idea is that in the standard scenarios, you'll try to steal those tokens and get them off map. And then, of course, you have a campaign system so that you can retain your crews, they can level up, acquire new stuff between scenarios, so different things may happen, they collect experience, all the stuff that we have learned to love from role-playing games, and then now we also like in wargaming. So this is the general idea behind Stargrave. So Stargrave is Frostgrave on other planets, on distant sci-fi planets, which also means a Western movie in the future, and this kind of sort of semi post-apocalyptic world. I was gonna say it's Frostgrave in space, but the space element is not really there. It's about skirmishes in crazy planets, crazy places, etc., 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 with a sci-fi element. Maybe in the future we'll get more dogfighting in space and more about the traveling, etc., etc., etc. So basically, this is a variant of Frostgrave, especially the Archipelago element, with a science fiction background, which is good or bad. It all depends on you. If you wanted a game that was completely different with some major general retooling, this is not it. So I would say whatever you think about Frostgrave Archipelago, you're gonna feel pretty much the same here. On one hand, you're gonna be at home right away, because if you know that game, is gonna be very easy to learn this one. On the other hand, maybe it's a little bit redundant. If you like science fiction better than fantasy, then by all means, I think you're gonna like this one very, very much. And having a foundation in Frostgrave so that you can jump into Stargrave a little more easily is probably gonna be useful, because the game can be a little daunting at the beginning, can be a little confusing. I knew all the previous Frostgrave games and supplements, and still having to learn all the new core powers. So, well, they're just a lot. And I played the game solitaire, so I just created different crews and I had them fight against each other. This way I could just take as much time as I wanted, taking a break and going check and double check what exactly does this power do. Because it's not just about memorizing what they do, it's about really getting a sense of what they can do for you, which is a different story. How can I synergize them? At the beginning, I make some crews kind of randomly. I just give them whatever power I don't know, then what I see the name, I don't know what it does. I'll give them that power, so I'm forced to learn it. And of course, they don't go together. You're like, oh, that sounded good on paper, but that's just habitual. Anytime you help you start synergizing things a little bit better. So it takes, even if you're familiar with the sources of this one, just because of the powers and the new classes, it takes some time.
And actually, one of the most innovative things, which is you can mix a captain and a number one of different classes, I think is one of the biggest differences between the two games, and one of the best things of Stargrave. That, of course, means, right, again, the learning curve is going to be made steeper precisely by that, because you want to see those synergies. And then you had to figure out not just what two classes do. In Frostgrave, you know, the class of one mage and the class of the other mage is the same as those of the main helpers. So you have to really learn two of them to start playing. If you want to start mixing and matching, you're working with four. So the overall number of unique game effects and interactions at play can be daunting. If you're willing to put in all the work and the self-training to familiarize yourself with those effects, then of course you have a really fun and interesting situation with just so many different options, so many tactical possibilities, so many crazy things that may happen here. 20-sided die, not everybody likes that vast range of things that you can hear, plus that you have here, plus the 20 and the 1 with the critical failure and the critical success. When you have such large range, it can sometimes feel a bit frustrating because you did synergize your core powers and weapons and armors and positions and unique effects of that scenario, and then you roll very poorly and the other side rolls very, very richly, because that would be the opposite of rolling poorly. And so that it maybe feels like all the homework that you put into those effects was for nothing. But overall, you're going to roll so many dice for so many different effects that things even themselves out. You're still going to have an overall bell curve sort of things in which good gameplay, good use of the effects and of your resources overall in the big scheme still gonna pay off. So the beauty of the original Frostgrave was in the richness of the story world and the variety of effects, and you have the same thing here. Although it is fun to see all of these crazy effects coming together, different classes, different monsters, etc. Like the original Frostgrave, I do like the role of the non-playing characters. They really add a lot, and they really add also more of a narrative feel to the entire story. You don't control everybody that is in the battlefield. You don't control everybody who is in the story world. Again, it gives you more the illusion of a story world that is not being made up as a play, but a story world that somehow was already there, and I'm entering, I'm exploring, I'm discovering. It's an illusion, and I know that it is, but it still works and it still entertains me as I get, again, the feeling, the illusion that I'm discovering a fantasy world where I'm not in control of everything that happens. That's something that I really enjoyed in an entire other family of games, the reaction games by 2-Hour War Games. I think those are the ones that really pioneered very well the idea of a world that you're exploring and inhabiting. And it's fun and nice to see that later similarly was re-implemented, whether directly inspired or not, I don't know. But to see the same idea in Frostgrave and in Stargrave. Incidentally, just for personal taste, I slightly prefer fantasy settings. There is just something powerful and archetypical. There's also the fact that it's an orc, it's a golem, it's an elf. I already know all that stuff. Here I read the bestiary and some of them have these like weird sounding animals and those descriptions. They're just a little less iconic for me. And that's entirely personal taste. Maybe you killed enough dragons and you played enough elves in your life, then you can be a biomorph that works together with a psionicist, and that's going to be great for you. So just for personal taste, I put it out there. I slightly prefer Frostgrave because I slightly prefer fantasy to science fiction when it comes to games. That's just my preference. So, in any case, is Stargrave basically Frostgrave in space? I would say by and large, yes. The overlapping are massive. There are some interesting differences, again, in the new effects, the new classes, new interactions, weapons, fun stuff happening there. But overall, don't expect a completely different experience, or even a vastly different experience, really. Which can be good or can be bad, entirely up to you. Frostgrave in space equal Stargrave. And that's pretty much, in a nutshell, my assessment. I enjoyed it. Mind you, I enjoyed it. All the fun stuff of Frostgrave, again, with a fairly steep learning curve. But a lot of fun action, a lot of interesting tactical options, if you're willing to put it in homework, and if you enjoy this sort of post-apocalyptic science fiction scenario.